You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney and I'm your host and instructor. If you haven't seen our show before, I'm a plant pathologist and a botanist and an arborist and a pest control advisor. I've worked in the nursery and landscape industry for many years, more than I like to admit. And this is a live broadcast and you can call in with your questions about your garden. I like to say we talk about everything from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. So we'll talk about anything you want to talk about. Give us a call, 800-339-1193, and we'll talk about your garden or whatever you want to talk about in terms of plant materials or gardens. Today we're going to talk about citrus, and you can see I have a couple of different kinds of citrus here. We're going to talk about all the different kinds of citrus. We're going to talk about how to take care of your citrus, the diseases and the pests that citrus get, how to water, how to fertilize. We're going to try and talk about everything about citrus. Now, we like to start the show with a mystery plant and see if you can guess what it is and call in and tell us what you think it is. Let's pull this mystery plant over here. Here it is. Now, this is a flowering shrub. I'll look it up later. I don't remember where it's native to. I think probably Asia or China. That's my best guess, because the common name actually has China in it. But if you know the common name, now there's a lot of varieties. This particular one is this deep red. This is the flower, obviously. So if you recognize this plant, this is a fairly drought-tolerant plant that flowers nicely, will take quite a bit of sun, especially along the coast, it'll take more sun. So this is a really nice plant material to grow in your garden. It gives you nice flowers, and there's a lot of different varieties. There's some varieties that are woody and upright, and some need to be supported on fences or trellis. But this is our mystery plant. Let me move this guy over here. And we're just gonna, there it is. That's a good look at him. But we'll just leave it there to the side. And give us a call if you recognize that plant. I don't wanna block the other camera. So let's just bring that right there. And there, it's in the side of the screen, and you can remember that that's our mystery plant, and you can give us a call and take a guess. You can email in your questions or your guess of our mystery plant at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. Of course, we are broadcasting from the campus of Cal State Dominguez Hills in Carson, and it's a beautiful day out in Southern California, nice and warm. Here we are after the first week of March, 2015, and there's a lot to do in your garden. If this is the time you want to start your vegetable garden, your summer vegetables. If you had a winter vegetable garden, maybe some of your winter vegetables are starting to, peter out a little bit, not do well, but this is a great time to get your tomatoes in. Anything in the Solanaceae, tomatoes, peppers, eggplant, potato, get your squash in, get some beans in, pole beans, bush beans, maybe some, you can still grow lettuce. You don't want to try to grow any head lettuce at this point in time. You want to grow leaf lettuce through the summer. It'll tend to bolt pretty fast, even though it's still just leaf lettuce, but you'll never get a head on head lettuce this time of year. Head lettuce is really a winter crop. So we also have upcoming events that you can put on your calendar if you're a student. You need to attend an outside event and write an essay about what you learned. The idea, of course, is to go out and learn something new about plants or gardens. Go to any kind of meeting. We have four events on today's calendar, so let's look at our first event. And this is Tomato Mania, and this will be at Descanso Gardens, March 28th to 29th, from 9 to 5. And they've got a number of things. They have a plant sale on both days from 9 to 5 on the main lawn. And there will be hundreds of healthy seedlings, heirloom varieties, old favorites, and unusual offerings. And then we also have Grow Great Tomatoes, which will be Saturday, a lecture on Saturday, to learn the basics of tomato growing. And then Tomato Faves from Patina on both days. Purchase tasty tomato favorites, including homemade tomato soup, BLT sandwiches, and build your own Bloody Mary I don't know what this is, a Michelada bar. Then there's also a tomato cooking demo on both days at noon. Learn some fresh new spins on cooking with this favorite from a Patina chef. So that's Tomato Mania. We'll be at Descanso Garden. In addition to that, we have the Altadena Community Gardening, or Community Garden, and this is University of California, Los Angeles County is sponsoring a new garden in Altadena, and March 21st, 28th, April 11th, 18th, 9:30 to 12:30. This is at the Community Garden at Lutheran Church, will be May 16th, and that is a course on that date. And then the beginning community garden is 21st, 28th, April 11th. So put that on your calendar and give them a call at 661-713-7003 for more information. In addition to that, we have the Cherry Blossom Festival will be at Descanso Gardens March 21st and 22nd. And this is an opportunity to go see some absolutely spectacular flowering cherries that do quite well in Southern California. And you can give them a call at 818-949-4200 for more information on that. In addition to that, we have our last event, which is the Ikebana Flower Arranging Class at Los Angeles County Arboretum on March 20th from 9:30 to 11:30 in the Bamboo Room under the library. Give them a call at 626-821-4623 for more information on that. And so that's our upcoming events. And of course, today we are talking about citrus, so I've got a bunch of things to show you about citrus. Before I go into a lot of the details on citrus, let's take a look at a couple books. Now, this isn't really about citrus, but I wanted to share this book with you. This is a California Flora and Supplement by Munz in collaboration with Keck. And this is a key. This is a dichotomous key. This book you can use to identify native plants and introduced plants that grow naturally in Southern California or in all of California. Because, you know, not landscape plants. So if you're hiking in the Santa Monica Mountains, or if you're up in an area, or just in a vacant lot and you see weeds growing in the vacant lot, well, you can use this book to determine the name of the plant. What is the genus and what is the species? So, this is a dichotomous key. I've talked about keys before. This is a fairly technical key. And the other one that people love to use is, now I've forgotten the name of it, is, there's a second one and the name just dropped right out of my head. This is the one I used when I took, an introduction to native plants at Cal Poly Pomona. And it was plant taxonomy that I took, and it was all natives. So all the natives are in here, and so if you're out walking, you see a plant on your hike, and you want to figure it out, this is the book. And it's not a cheap book, it's probably over $100. Now the other books I want to show you, since we're talking about citrus, this is the Compendium of Citrus Diseases from the American Phytopathological Society. They have a whole series of these. And in here you can look up any disease that affects citrus. That would be fungal diseases, bacterial diseases, viral diseases, or viroid diseases. And fairly technical. Many of you may not really be interested in purchasing something like this, but there probably is a copy available at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. And if not, I'm not sure where you would see a copy, actually. If we go to the overhead, I'll just show you a little bit about what it covers. Let's just go to some of the color plates. Let's go to the overhead. Many of you may not realize how many diseases there are of citrus, and there are a lot, but they're mostly controlled through propagation. and making sure you get clean plants when you buy it. But if we go to the overhead and take a look at some of the color plates in this, you can see how this book is organized. So here are the plates showing the various diseases that might affect your citrus. This is black spot. This is anthracnose, alternaria leaf spot. Down here, this is botrytis destroying a young fruit. There's another botrytis damage down here in the corner. And then, there's a full description, post-harvest fungal diseases. So it covers all the diseases that occur around the world on citrus. Now, a little more helpful maybe to growers in California, is the integrated pest management guide for citrus from the University of California. And this is really comprehensive. It covers all the insects, all the diseases, talks about fertilization and watering and everything there is that you can think about in terms of citrus. And let's just take a quick look at what's inside. Let's take a look here. And look at the table of contents just to give you an idea of what's in here. Managing pests in citrus. Diseases, I know you can't read that. Over here, nematodes, weeds. Vertebrate pests over here on this side. We got vertebrate pests, insect, mites, snails. Citrus tree development, the growth requirements, seasonal cycle of citrus, growth requirements. Integrated pest management talks about integrated pest management and the major growing areas of citrus in California. So it talks about everything there is to know about citrus. And, here you've got a little thing on the Vidalia beetle and cottony cushiony scale, which is a really fascinating story. Now, I always like to see, I'm out walking around a lot out in various areas of Southern California. I was in Santa Monica yesterday, and I was at a farmer's market, and I saw in the parking lot there, they were growing daylily. And there is a disease of daylily that was a big deal when it first showed up. And now it's not such a big deal because it's widespread and all over the place. So let's take a look at this. And these are daylily leaves. And this is rust. This is daylily rust. And of course, the rusts are very host specific. So this fungus, this rust fungus that infects daylily will not infect really any other plants other than daylily. But let's take a look at this and see if we can see it here. First off, you can see the damage to the tips, which is pretty characteristic, but what you're really looking for are the little orange pustules. And here's one right here. I don't know if you can see it. It's awfully small. But they're little orange pustules, very similar to what you would see on rose rust on the back of rose leaves. Some of these had a little more. This, you can see it a little better. Here are the pustules right here. Let's see if I can, you can see them here. They're awfully small, I know, on your screen. But this is daylily rust, very common on daylily now. It was introduced probably about 5 to 10 years ago with a shipment of daylilies from Florida that originally introduced into Florida and then spread through the rest of the United States where people grow daylily. So that's daylily rust. So how do you deal with it? Well, if you've got it on your daylilies, what you need to do is make sure, especially at the end of the season, like in the late fall, you cut all the leaves off to the ground and then clean them all up and put them in the trash rather than mulch them. I'd just go ahead and put them in the trash. There's not very much green waste anyway. And then when it starts to grow in the spring, you probably want to apply a fungicide a couple times to prevent infection. And often, if you really cut them to the ground and a couple of fungicide treatments, you can get rid of it. I don't think there's an alternate host for it. So if you can just get rid of the inoculum from the previous seasons and prevent infection, it's not that hard of a rust to control. Now, we are talking about citrus today, so let's start talking about citrus. And let's just get to my notes and think if there's anything else I want to show you. We're going to be cutting this in half in a minute because that's going to be really fun. Well, let me just talk about another little pest real quick but this is a pest of citrus. These are lemons. Let's go to the overhead and you can see that they aren't yellow. They are kind of silvery or grayish. They're kind of hard. And if you cut them open, they're quite dry. And this is caused by the citrus rust mite, or the silvery mite. On oranges, it causes the oranges to be kind of streaked with rust colors, or the whole thing will get rust colored. But you can see these lemons are very kind of a silvery color or a grayish color instead of a bright yellow. And they're quite firm and hard compared to a regular lemon. This is the citrus rust mite, and sometimes referred to as the silvery mite because of its effect on lemons. So this isn't all that hard to control with oils and soaps, frequent sprays of oils and soaps, maybe a pyrethrin with an oil or soap. If you don't get good control that way, you might need to use a broad-spectrum insecticide, but you want to make sure it controls mites. They feed on lemons, they feed almost exclusively on the fruit. So as soon as the fruit gets to a certain size, about the size of a dime, is when you want to start your sprays. If you have any fruit that look like this in the tree, you should pick all that fruit out of the tree and discard it. It's very dry. It's not really worth saving or trying to use. So that's the citrus rust mite. It affects oranges and lemons. And let's see if I've got anything else I want to look at right away. No, that's it. So let's talk about citrus. Let's talk about the genus. And I've mentioned before in taxonomy, you've got a genus. And a genus will have a certain number of species within it. So the genus for citrus is citrus. That's the genus. And all citrus trees are of the single genus citrus, and remain largely interbreedable, which means you can cross all the species and get viable hybrids that will produce seed. So it's believed there's really like one super species, or the alternative concept is that there's four ancestral species to citrus. And of course, citrus have been propagated and grown for thousands of years. Molecular studies support that there are four ancestral species: citron, pomelo, mandarin, and papadeus were the ancestors of all other citrus species and their varieties. And all those varieties resulted from breeding or natural hybridization among the parental species. For instance, oranges are Citrus sinensis, lemons are Citrus X limon, grapefruit is Citrus paradisi, it should actually be Citrus X paradisi, it's a hybrid as well, lime, mostly Citrus arantifolia, and the key lime. Citrus is common term and genus of flowering plants in the Rutaceae, so it's in the rue family. It is not actually clear how many original species there are because it's been grown for so long. People have selected varieties, hybridized it extensively. So natural and cultivated origin hybrids include oranges, grapefruit, lemons, limes, and tangerines. The kumquats are a group of small fruit-bearing trees in the flowering plant Rutaceae in the genus Fortinella. But a lot of people now think that kumquats should not be in Fortinella and should be in citrus. The sweet orange is Citrus sinensis. So if we can bring up a picture, our first picture. The orange is a hybrid of ancient cultivated origin, possibly between pomelo and tangerine, Citrus reticulata. And pomelo is Citrus maxima. So here you see the typical orange. Of course, there are navel oranges, and there are Valencia oranges, there are blood oranges, there are many different kinds of oranges. They all originated in Southeast Asia. The Citrus sinensis is called sweet orange to distinguish it from Citrus aurantium, which is called the bitter orange. The Persian orange, grown widely in Southern Europe after its introduction to Italy in the 11th century, was bitter, and that was Citrus aurantium. Sweet oranges brought to Europe in the 15th century from India by Portuguese traders quickly displaced the bitter and are now the most common variety of orange cultivated. So they're called sweet orange. Portuguese, Spanish, Arab, and Dutch sailors planted citrus trees along trade routes to prevent scurvy. Many of you have probably heard that if you brought citrus with you on these long citrus voyages, you could prevent vitamin C deficiency, which causes scurvy. On his second voyage in 1493, Christopher Columbus brought seeds of oranges, lemons, and citrons to Haiti and the Caribbean. They were introduced in Florida, along with lemons, in 1513 by Spanish explorer Juan Ponce de Leon, and were introduced to Hawaii in 1792. The navel orange has a fascinating history, and let's go ahead and bring up just some other pictures as we move along here, and we'll talk about the navel orange. Go ahead and bring up number two and then number three. The navel orange was discovered in 1820 in Bahia, Brazil, when a mutation occurred in a grove of sweet orange trees. In 1872, Brazil sent a dozen navel orange seedlings to the U.S. Department of Agriculture in Washington, D.C. The next year, Mrs. Eliza Tibbetts of Riverside was given two trees from USDA, and the seedlings began producing fruit in 1878, 6 years after she received them. This variety of orange became known as the Riverside orange, but the name was changed to Washington for better national appeal. Other varieties of the navel orange include Atwood, Thompson, Fisher, and Lane Late, and there are many others. By 1882, over 500,000 citrus trees were growing in California. This time of history became known as the Other California Gold Rush, which established the citrus industry. Today, the parent Washington navel orange tree still stands in Riverside, though it was transplanted in 1902 from its original home to a different location. It's now in a center island on Magnolia Street in Riverside. Despite its age, the tree, which is now protected, continues to bear fruit to this day. So that citrus, the Washington navel, let's bring up number four. Of course, that's delicious orange juice. You see the Washington navel. Navels are characterized by a second fruit at the base of the fruit, and that's what causes a navel. So that is a Washington, that's a navel. That's the second fruit. So the mutation was observed first in 1820. And the mutation causes navel oranges to develop a second orange at the base of the original fruit, opposite the stem. The second orange develops as a conjoined twin in a set of smaller segments embedded with the peel of the larger orange. From the outside, it looks similar to the human navel. Because the mutation left the fruit seedless and therefore sterile, the only means available to cultivate more of this new variety is to graft cuttings onto other varieties of citrus trees. And two of those cuttings were grafted and sent, of course, in 1870, and developed was the main variety which produced the entire citrus industry in California. Of course, Valencias are grown in California to some extent, but mostly it's navels. A Washington navel, widely adapted in desert, best in interior, early to midwinter. Another variety is the Caracara. First rosy flesh navel, early to midwinter with a rich flavor. Lane Late is a late ripening navel, ripens into the summer. Skaggs Bonanza is a variant of Washington, colors early, heavily bearing, but unfortunately it's very short-lived due to stress. And so let's let's just talk about that Skaggs Bonanza for a minute. Skaggs Bonanza would color up in November, well before they're ripe. Navel oranges reach their peak of flavor in January and February. So it's a winter, and almost all citrus is ripe in the winter. Valencias are the exception. Valencias are picked in the summer. But of course, now we've got early Valencias, we've got late Valencias, we've got late navel. So if you can pick a variety that you can have oranges easily year-round in your garden. But Skaggs Bonanza is an interesting story. Because it colored up early in November, you could pick them and get a very high price and ship them before the Christmas season. So they would go out in gift baskets. But they weren't ripe. It is a navel. And it's going to reach its peak of flavor in January. If you pick it in November, it's not going to be sweet. It's not going to be particularly sweet at all. And so people would get those Skaggs Bonanzas and think, what's wrong with this orange? It's orange, it's beautiful, it's a great looking fruit. It just didn't have the flavor. And so a lot of people put a lot of money into growing those. But then it turned out, after about 10 years, the trees started to die. Because the reason they were producing their fruit or coloring up early in November is because they were under a lot of stress. They weren't particularly graft compatible, like a lot of the citrus are. So let's talk about Valencias. The Valencia orange first created, no, that's absolutely incorrect. The Valencia orange originated in Spain. It was first discovered in the Azores Islands in Portugal in 1870. An Englishman named Thomas Rivers recognized that the variety matured later than most and brought the plant to Florida, where it was cultivated and named the Excelsior. The Valencia's name changed many times until it was eventually named after a late maturing orange grown in Valencia region of Spain. And of course, it turned out it's the exact same variety that a lot of people were growing under different names. And today, everyone knows it as Valencia. Now, from the citrus industry, which is a multi-volume set published in 1967, this is what it says about the Valencia. The English nurseryman, Thomas Rivers of Sawbridgeworth, imported this variety from the Azore Islands and cataloged it in 1865 under the name Excelsior. About 1870, he provided trees to S.B. Parsons, a Long Island nurseryman, and in 1876, he sent trees to A.B. Chapman of San Gabriel, California. In the meantime, Parsons sold trees to E.H. Hart of Federal Point, Florida, where in 1877, the variety received the name Hart's Tardif. According to Weber, the trees received by Chapman were unlabeled and included several varieties, one of which proved to be a late maturing and was provisionally called Rivers Late. So you can see that it had a lot of names. A few years later, Chapman changed the name to Valencia Late at the suggestion of a Spanish visitor who pronounced it similar to a late maturing variety in the region of Valencia. It was not until several decades later that comparisons in California established the fact that these two indistinguishable varieties were identical, and much later that this fact received recognition in Florida. So it is a late season fruit, ripening in the summer, so it has to be on the tree about 16 to 18 months, whereas navels are on the tree for about 10 to 11 months before they ripen. Name comes, of course, from Valencia, Spain. The orange was later sold to the Irvine Company, who would dedicate nearly half their land to its cultivation. And of course, Orange County was named after the orange trees that were grown by the Irvine Company in that area. The success of this crop likely led to the naming of Orange County. The Irvine Company's Valencia operation later split from the company and became Sunkist. Cultivation of the Valencia in Orange County had all but ceased by the 1990s due to the rising property costs, which drove most of what remained of the Southern California orange industry into Florida. Now, California still has a very large citrus industry worth several billion dollars a year, employing thousands of people. Now, the commercial harvest season in Florida runs from March to June. Worldwide, Valencia oranges are prized as the only variety of orange in season during the summer. Most widely planted orange in the world varieties, there's Campbell, Delta, Midnight, are early ripening, nearly seedless. Now let's take a look at our next picture, which is number 5. And this is the blood orange. And you can bring up the next picture as well. The blood orange is, of course, a variety of the sweet orange, Citrus sinensis. The distinctive dark flesh color is due to the presence of anthocyanin, a pigment common to many flowers and fruit, but uncommon in citrus fruits. Often described as a hybrid between the pomelo and tangerine, it is actually just a mutation off of sweet orange. The three most common types of blood oranges are Tacaro, which is known from Italy, the Sanguinello from Spain, and the Moro, the newest variety of the three. So now I was at this, let's bring up the next picture, which also shows blood oranges. And I want to tell you that blood oranges, to me, are some of the most delicious oranges you'll ever taste. And let's take a look at these blood oranges that I bought yesterday at a farmer's market in Santa Monica. And these haven't colored up nearly as nicely as they should. If you get really hot days and cold nights, it'll color up really, really nicely. But if you have really mild temperatures, it kind of looks like this. They aren't marketed particularly very much. If you think about fruit and fruit sales at supermarkets, there's a lot of competition for fruit. You've got all the other kinds of fruit, bananas and apples and peaches and everything else. And so, the people who market oranges, they're selling lemons and limes and grapefruits and oranges. And the question is, do they want to try and market blood oranges? Well, they don't like the name. They think that people won't like the name. And so you don't usually see them very often in supermarkets, but you can find them in the farmers markets. And so just going to slice this up a little bit and see how delicious it really is. Let's come back to me, because this is going to be really good. That's pretty good. It's not as good as it could be. It didn't color up quite enough. So I got these at a farmer's market yesterday. Let's take a look at another one. Usually if there's a lot of red in the rind, see, these just didn't color up very good. It just hadn't been cold enough at night during the growing season. You know, you need those hot days, cold nights, to really get them to color up. So let's just talk about it. Let's just talk about the Moro. A recent addition to the blood orange family is the most colorful of the three types, with a deep purple reddish and reddish orange rind. So the rind itself will be reddish as well. The Moro variety is believed to originate at the beginning of the 19th century in the citrus growing area in Lentini, in the province of Siracusa, in Sicily, as a bud mutation from Sanguino. The Tarocco is a medium-sized fruit and perhaps the sweetest and most flavorful of the three types. The Sanguinino, also called Sanguinini, is in the U.S., it's Sicilian common name, discovered in Spain in 1929, has reddish skin, few seeds, and sweet, tender flesh. Blood oranges cultivated in the United States are in season from December to March in Texas and from November to May in California. So we have a longer season in California. While the tree will grow and bear fruit in Florida, the Mediterranean temperature variation between day and night seems to be necessary to develop the distinctive red color. That means you need hot days and cold nights to get the color. So that's the blood orange, and I got to tell you, I think blood oranges make the best juice and are some of the sweetest and most delicious oranges you could ever grow. Let's take a look at some more of the bloods. Here's blood orange number three, the third of the, and then take a look at this next one. This is the Smith Red. This is a variety of blood orange, another variety. And look how red that is. That's almost absolutely blood. And this picture is by David Karp, who I just recently met and is a really nice guy. So the sour orange is Citrus aurantium, and it's called the sour orange or the bitter orange or the Seville orange. And they have a big block of those at the Arboretum, and they are sour and bitter. They look, they're orange, got the fruit all over the tree, you cut it open, you taste it, and it is not pleasant. If you were going to make orange juice out of it, you'd probably have to add a lot of sugar. Now, I have a video clip from the University of California Germplasm Repository, this video clip discusses a bunch of different kinds of citrus, and will show you the parent navel in Riverside. So let's go to that video clip, and then when we come back, we'll talk more about oranges or citrus. Unfortunately, we're having technical difficulties with the audio portion of that video. Hopefully, we can fix that for you. But what you saw there was the original parent navel, which is still alive and doing fairly well in Riverside on Magnolia. Let's talk a little bit about grapefruit, and hopefully, we'll get that video back for you in a moment, because it's really a nice little clip showing you a lot of different varieties. The grapefruit. And if we bring up number eight, or number nine, I'm showing you a grapefruit. Grapefruit is, of course, citrus, grown for its bitter fruit, which is originally named the forbidden fruit of Barbados. The fruit was first documented in 1750 by the Reverend Griffith Hughes, describing specimens from Barbados. It had developed as a hybrid of the pomelo, Citrus maxima, with the sweet orange, Citrus sinensis, though it is closer to the pomelo. The grapefruit was known as the shaddock until the 1800s, taking the name from Captain Shaddock, who introduced the pomelo to the Caribbean from Polynesia in the 17th century. Its current name alludes to clusters of the fruit on the tree, which often appear similar to grapes. So if you ever wondered why they call it grapefruit, when it doesn't really look like a grape at all, it's because in the tree, there'll be two or three or several fruit together, similar to a cluster of grapes. Botanically, it was not distinguished from the pomelo until the 1830s, when it was given the name Citrus ex paradisi. The 1929 ruby red patent was associated with real commercial success, which came after the discovery of a red grapefruit growing on a pink variety. The red grapefruit, starting from ruby red, has even become a symbol of a symbol fruit for Texas. Needs heat for sweet, tart fruit, best in desert, where fruit ripens in 9 months. And that's generally true of a lot of citrus. You need warm, really hot summers to really sweeten up the fruit. There are some varieties you can grow right along the coast that don't need as much heat. We'll talk about those in a minute. But of course, historically in Southern California, lemons were grown along the coast because they don't sweeten up and you didn't need the heat. They did really well along the coast. And today, lemons are still grown mostly along the coast in Ventura County and right along that coastal area. Oranges were grown in the hot inland valleys, like the San Gabriel Valley. And grapefruit are grown out in the desert, out in the Coachella area, because they need even more heat to get a little sweeter, because, of course, they're not as sweet as oranges to begin with. They're a little sour. And in order to get a little, and if they're not, if you don't have the heat, they don't really sweeten up at all. So Rio Red is the current, as of 2007, Texas grapefruit with registered trademarks Rio Star and Ruby Sweet, also sometimes promoted as Reddest or Texas Choice. Grapefruit can have a number of interactions with drugs. This is an interesting phenomena with grapefruits, increasing the effective potency of various prescription drugs. Actually, what happens is you absorb more of it. If you eat grapefruit with your prescription drugs, you'll absorb more of it, and you actually will get an overdose. So you'll often see warnings now on some prescription drugs not to eat grapefruits when you're taking these prescriptions. And I was just talking to some people who yesterday who noted that they can't eat grapefruits because of the prescriptions they're on. Grapefruit forms a core part of the grapefruit diet, the theory being that the fruit's low glycemic index is able to help the body's metabolism burn fat. The effect of grapefruit juice with regard to drug absorption was originally discovered in 1989. However, the effects came well publicized after being responsible for a number of deaths due to overdosing on medications. So there's a lot of varieties of grapefruit. The flame is seedless with red flesh. The marsh, main white flesh commercial variety. Mellow gold, grapefruit pomelo hybrid, needs less heat. Fruit does not hold well on tree. Mellow gold is the one you can grow right along the coast. It'll do fairly well. Oro Blanco is a sister to mellow gold, with sweeter seedless white flesh. Red blush, also known as ruby or ruby red, seedless grapefruit with red tinted flesh, fades to pink by end of season. The Rio Red is seedless, good rind blush, nearly as red as Star Ruby, more dependable producer than Star Ruby. And of course, Star Ruby is seedless, reddish color, prone to cold damage, erratic bearing, does not withstand desert heat. So you probably would want to go, if you want to grow a grapefruit and you're in one of the hot inland valleys, I would go with Rio Red. If you're right along the coast, I would go with Oro Blanco or Mellow Gold. Let's take a look at a number 10, which is the pink grapefruit. Let's bring that up. So here you got a just absolutely delicious looking a grapefruit. Hopefully, let's see if our video is working now. Maybe the control room could send me a message if it's not yet. Okay. Okay, let's take a look at lemon. Origin. of the lemon has remained a mystery. In 1700s and 1800s, lemons were increasingly planted in Florida and California, where lemons began to be used in cooking and flavoring. Though it is widely presumed that lemons first grew in India, northern Burma, and China, it was later introduced to Persia and then to Iraq and Egypt around AD 700. Of course, citrus have been around for literally thousands of years. The lemon was first recorded in literature in a 10th century Arabic thesis on farming and was also used as an ornamental plant in early Islamic gardens. It was distributed widely through the Arab world and the Mediterranean region between AD 1000 and AD 1150. Lemons entered Europe near southern Italy no later than the first century AD during the time of ancient Rome. It was later introduced to the Americas in 1493 when Christopher Columbus brought lemon seeds to Hispaniola along his voyages. In the 1700s and late 1800s, lemons were increasingly planted in Florida and California when lemons began to be used in cooking and flavoring. In 1747, James Lind's experiments on seamen suffering from scurvy involved adding vitamin C to their diets through lemon juice. The Eureka is the standard lemon of markets, bears year-round to 20 feet with few thorns. Lisbon is vigorous, upright with many thorns, 20 to 25 feet tall. Fruit nearly identical to Eureka, ripens mostly in fall, some fruit year-round, and the Lisbon is the best lemon for Arizona. The Meyer lemon actually is a cross between a lemon and possibly an orange or a mandarin, was named for Frank Meyer, who discovered it in 1908. It is thin-skinned and slightly less acidic than the Lisbon and Eureka lemons, and what that means is it's not sour like lemons, it's kind of sweet. The improved Meyer is called that because it is more disease resistant. The Ponderosa is a huge, rough lemon with thick, coarse skin, up to 2 pounds, with a mild lemon flavor. Sun Gold is an attractive semi-dwarf with green striped yellow fruit. And let's take a look at the pink variegated Eureka, which is our next picture, and bring that up full screen. And so this is the variegated pink is a sport of Eureka with green and white leaves and green stripes on immature fruit. So when it matures, you'll lose these green stripes. When it's fully mature, you won't see those green stripes nearly as much, and it's pink on the inside. Okay, I see our video is ready now. So let's go to our first video talking about the parent Washington Naval in Riverside and some of the interesting citrus that you find at the Citrus Experiment Station in Riverside, California.
Hi, I'm Tom Spellman with Dave Wilson Nursery. Today, we're going to take a tour of the Citrus Experiment Station at UC Riverside. It's been in existence for over 100 years. It has a varietal collection of well over 1,000 citrus varieties. And I thought it would be interesting to start at kind of a historic point in the citrus industry. Right behind me is the original parent navel orange tree, planted here in Riverside in 1873. So it's been here now for 136 years. This is an area that at one time was an orange grove, a flourishing orange grove. And now it's right in the middle of the city, as you can tell by the traffic going around me. This tree is actually a living landmark here in the state of California, and a cherished landmark at that. It's historic landmark number 20. It's maintained by the varietal collection group at UC Riverside. They work on this tree all the time to keep it healthy. In fact, back in the 1980s, this tree was actually inarched in saying the tree was not healthy. The tree was dying, and it was losing its root system to root rot. So what the university did was they brought in seedlings of other citrus varieties, planted them around the base of the tree, and actually grafted them up into the base of the tree to keep it alive. So here it is, beautiful landmark, 136 years old, the original navel orange tree, where all navel oranges have come from that are in existence today. We're talking about the parent of millions of trees. And we're going to go to the varietal collection now, and we're going to see some phenomenal, unusual citrus varieties today. This morning, we're out on the UC Riverside Citrus Varietal Collection Block. This is our friend Robert Kruger. He's the curator of the USDA germplasm block of citrus here in Riverside.
Thanks, Tom. We are located here at the UC Riverside Citrus Variety Collection, which we use as a field collection for our efforts in genetic resource conservation. The variety collection is over 100 years old at this point and has moved around here in Riverside over the decades from across town to different places on the Citrus Experiment Station. We currently have about 1,100 different types of citrus and related genera. So today we're going to take a look at some of the more unusual types of citrus that we have here that might be of interest to people. Tom, this is the Buddha's Hand citron. Citrons are one of our basic types of citrus, and they originated around the area of southern China or northern India. And what's interesting about the Buddha's Hand is that developmentally, in the development of the citrus fruit, normally when you cut open a citrus fruit, you see the different segments. With the Buddha's Hand, they never fuse during the fruit development process, and so they stay open like that. And if you cut them open, which we'll do here, you'll see they have no flesh in them. What's interesting about a lot of these citrons is, not necessarily this one, even though they have no flesh, the rind is slightly sweet. And we'll go ahead and I'll take a taste of this one. I don't believe this is one of the sweeter rinds, though. It's not the sweetest rind I've tasted, but it does have a little bit of flavor there.
Well, one thing that I've always liked to use citron for, especially the Buddha's Hand, number one, they're ornamentally just a unique piece of fruit to use mm-hmm. as a display in the house. But unfortunately on camera, you can't pick this up, but the fragrance is just phenomenal. It's a very fresh, light citrusy flavor, and the aroma of a fruit will just permeate and fill an entire room.
Tom, this is the Australian finger lime. This is actually traditionally been classified as a related species, microcitrus, because it's basically a smaller tree. Some of the recent taxonomic work has pulled this back into citrus. In any case, these are native to some of the desert areas in Australia, and they are sometimes consumed in Australia. If you cut them open, you can see a lot of these little small juice vesicles and small seeds, and they have a somewhat limey flavor, and hence they're called the finger lime, and they have a related rounder one, which is the Australian desert lime. These are becoming more of interest to chefs to use as a garnish.
One of the things that my wife and I have done with these in the past is use them as a sprinkle garnish over salads and also over cheesecake. Very, very nice enhancement on cheesecake.
This is Citrus hystrix, also called Kufre lime, and it's a pepita, so it's a little bit different than regular citrus. The pepitas have leaves with a very large petiole in comparison to regular citrus, and they also have more pronounced oil glands. This fruit is not edible, but the leaves are used in Southeast Asian cooking as a condiment. And the fruit, as I said, it's something that we don't eat because it's very pungent, very astringent. But traditionally, they would make a shampoo for it that was supposed to have some sort of insecticidal qualities to it. And so it tastes like a strongly flavored lemon or lime.
Yeah, and again, the aromatics of this variety are just incredible. The crushed leaf has a wonderful fragrance, and the fruit, the fragrance just permeates the area right here. It's a very, very incredible smell.
I'd like to, something to note about this particular tree is the presence of our yellow sticky trap. We have some invasive pests of citrus that are now threatening the California citrus industry, so we want to remain vigilant to find these pests. The Asian citrus psyllid is a carrier of the citrus Wanlong Bing disease, which can be very devastating to a citrus industry, so we want to exclude these pests from California. And these leaves of citrus hystrix are something that's commonly smuggled in from other countries to use in specific types of restaurants. So, you know, please remain vigilant that you try to avoid smuggling any fruit or citrus leaves into the country. Looking at a couple of other of the species that are maintained in the variety collection include things besides citrus, what we call the citrus relatives. These are all in the same family as citrus, but there's a lot of times distinctly different. This is Aigley marmalose, also called bale fruit in India. And this is a small one. These things will get to be about twice as big sometimes. This one's immature, but these have a hard shell. So I couldn't even cut it with this knife if I tried to. In order to get the seeds out of them for our scientific work, we have to beat on them with a hammer until they crack open.
Really?
And they're also full of a sticky, like mucilaginous matrix inside. And these are actually used in India to make a drink out of the interior goop, if you want to call it that, which is full of sugars.
Interesting.
And to the right here, we have Maria paniculata, also called orange jessamine. And this is planted a lot in various areas as an ornamental. It does very well here in Southern California, in Florida, in Hawaii. It's very fragrant and aromatic, has beautiful flowers, and produces, next spring anyway, some small, well, here's a fruit. Here's a very, that one fell off, but it produces this very small red or orange fruit. There, Tom's got it. This is a citron. This is a Yemen citron, and the citron is interesting for a couple of reasons. This is citrons were the first type of citrus fruit to get from Asia, from India and China, over to Europe in that area, and the scientific name is Citrus medica. Medica refers to an old name for Persia, so these were established in Persia after leaving India, but before getting to Europe. And these are used by the Jewish people in religious ceremonies, and they look for specific characteristics, which we'll see if we can get this cut open. So some of the citrons have a small amount of flesh in them, but the Yemen and some of the other types are interesting because they have no flesh, as with the Buddha's hand we saw earlier. And so again, this one you can sample a small piece of the rind, and anyway, these are some of the characteristics that are considered important for the ritual use of the citron. And there are certain areas of Morocco where some of the rabbis from New York go every year to collect the citron fruits from specific growers over there that have these really desirable characteristics. So one of the things we've done recently is acquire some citrons as seedlings from Morocco that we think will produce a type of fruit that is desired, and we can maintain it then as a propagation source and maybe get a source here in the U.S. Although I'm sure everybody would like to visit Morocco anyway.
Yeah, sounds like a good experience.
So there you go. That's a nice little clip. You got to see the parent navel, and if you're out in Riverside, drive by it. It's really fun to see. That parent navel has been inarched, which means they take young trees and they graft them into the trunk of the tree to start a new root system, and it works quite well. It's kind of labor intensive, but that works pretty good. Now, just some other notes about citrus. Oranges can be stored on the tree. The peak of picking for most of your oranges, not Valencias. Valencias are a summer fruit. So blood oranges, all the navel oranges, most of your oranges, you're going to hit their peak of flavor in January and February. They'll be fine in March too. But you typically don't want to leave a lot of fruit on the tree when it starts to bloom in March and set new fruit. Otherwise, you'll get a very heavy alternate bearing. If you have a lot of fruit on the tree and it blooms, it won't set as much fruit and you'll have less fruit next year. So one of the ways you smooth out your yield and get a consistent high yield is to pick all your fruit. But commercially, oranges are not picked and stored in packing houses. The orders come in. Sunkist, which is a cooperative, sends out the orders to the various growers, and they pick part of their grove. And then as the next order comes in, they go pick more of the grove. Then they'll pick the whole grove and put it in cold storage, like you might do with apples. And now lemons are picked by size. So throughout the year, because lemons will flower repeatedly throughout the year, four or five times you'll get a flowering. You'll get young fruit, a middle-sized fruit, mature fruit, colored-up fruit. It's all on the tree at one time. So they go through the groves and they pick according to size. Once it gets to a certain size, they pick the fruit, whether it's green or yellow. the green fruit going to cold storage, the yellow fruit gets sold. And they store the green fruit until the summer when the price of lemons goes way up. So they want to, you know, take advantage of the highest price, of course. And then they take the green fruit out of storage and they gas it with ethylene, and that causes it to turn yellow. Ethylene is a natural plant hormone that causes senescence in plants. It causes plant tissues to age. It occurs in many different parts of the plant, depending on the process you're talking about. A lot of fruit give off ethylene. Citrus, I believe, produce ethylene and give it off as they ripen. If you've ever heard that you can accelerate the ripening of avocados by putting them in a bag with bananas. Bananas give off ethylene. The ethylene causes the avocado to ripen faster. So that's how they use ethylene in citrus, is they'll take the lemons out that are dark green, gas them, and then off to the market. And they get a much higher price for lemons in the summer when people are cooking with them more, making lemonade, using them for a variety of purposes. So the next fruit we want to talk about is the lime, Citrus aurantifolia. Now, it's a number of different fruits, both species and hybrids, which are typically round, green to yellow in color, 3 to 6 centimeters in diameter, which is going to be about 2 or 3 inches in diameter, generally containing sour pulp and frequently associated with the lemon. So if we take a look at, number 14 here, this is a lime. The Bear's lime is the best for California and Hawaii. It's a type of Persian lime or Tahitian lime commonly grown in Florida. Very thorny, seedless, drops many leaves in the winter. What you might not realize is that some citrus are deciduous. They drop all their leaves in the winter. You don't think of that for oranges and lemons and limes, but limes, especially the Bear's lime, can look pretty thin in the winter, and it's natural. It's not that the tree is dying or sick. The fruit is green when immature and a yellowish green or a light green when it's ripe. And now the next fruit we want to talk about is the pomelo, Citrus maxima. The pomelo, also is Citrus maxima or Citrus grandis, is a citrus fruit native to Southeast Asia. And I didn't mention that there is a very nice section on citrus in the Sunset Western Garden book. So let's just take a quick look at that and see what they have to say about pomelo. Citrus in containers, citrus is houseplants, sweet orange, sour orange, mandarin, sour acid mandarin. Pomelo, the pomelo is the parent to grapefruit. And this is a pomelo. I bought this yesterday at a farmer's market in Santa Monica. It bears clusters of enormous round to pear-shaped fruits with thick rind and pith. Once peeled, fruit is just slightly bigger than a grapefruit. Different varieties range in flavor from sweet to fairly acidic, need less heat than grapefruit. They have Chandler, Rind King, and Tahitian as varieties. Other names for pomelo include pomelo, pomelo, Chinese grapefruit, Lusho fruit, Jabong, and Shaddock. Of course, I've mentioned already that it is the parent to the grapefruit. can weigh up to 20 pounds, which is outrageous. The Chandler is the most common variety. Pink flesh, flavorful, usually seedless. The Rind King, which I just mentioned a minute ago. White fleshed, not as sweet as Chandler, and seedy. Tahitian is greenish white flesh, moderately acid flavor with lime overtones. So let's take a look at my pomelo that I brought in. And I've cut these blunt oranges up. Well, let's cut up a pomelo, or pomelo. I'm just going to cut it. Well, let's cut it lengthwise. My knife is not as sharp as it used to be. I don't want to make too much of a mess trying to keep it on the plastic here. Take a look at this. So now the Chandler has pink flesh, flavorful, usually seedless. So I suspect this is a Chandler. There's no seeds. It's got the pink flesh, but look at the thickness of the rind. So this, you know, quite different, of course, from a grapefruit. But let's just take a little taste. And tell you the truth, I think, you know, if you're used to oranges and grapefruits, you may think this is not as good as those. Just take a little piece here. I'm not too excited about pomelos, I got to tell you. A lot of people love them. They're very popular in the Asian community. And a lot of people, a lot of people from Southeast Asia grow these in their gardens, particularly in the San Gabriel Valley, where you've got a large Asian population. They're very popular. So you will see them in farmers markets. You'll see them in specialty markets. But they're almost never marketed through the large commercial stores. And let's just see if I can prop that up so we can keep a little eye on it. I move on to our next variety. Well, before we move on to mandarin oranges, Citrus reticulata, let's pause for a station identification, remind you that you're watching Dominguez Hills Television, broadcast from Cal State Dominguez Hills, Cal State University Dominguez Hills, and this little brief station identification break will let you know a little bit about Cal State Dominguez Hills. We'll be back in a moment.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
You are to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. Want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
My name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California.
I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, my name is Leroy Harding. I'm a junior at California State University Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to Planetary Science and Astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California. Not just the United States, but the world, and I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world, and to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind, and it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Six. amazing.
This is good. I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude, love, love, love. Brother, love, that Mandarin sauce is ridiculous. The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Our champion is the Literal.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. The Gardens of California. My name's Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And we're talking about citrus today. You can call in with questions about your garden at 800-339-1193. And I'll do my best to answer your questions. I'm a plant pathologist and a botanist and a pest control advisor and an arborist, so I ought to be able to answer your question, hopefully. So if you had a problem in your garden, or if you want to talk about a certain plant material, how to grow it, how to take care of it, how to water it, fertilize it, prune it, give us a call and we'll talk about that. We've been talking about citrus for the last hour, and our next variety we want to talk about are mandarin oranges, which is citrus reticulata. And before we move on to that, let me just show you some more pictures of pumelos. And let's go to picture number 16. So now you can see this pumelo here. You can see how big it is. Take a look at some of these pumelos. Bring that up full screen. That's as big as her head. So these can be up to 20 pounds. And let's take a look at our next pumelo, number 17. Again, another pumelo. This is from, I'm trying to remember where I got this picture. But you can see how large they can get. And Chandler is the most commonly variety grown. So now let's talk about mandarin oranges. That's citrus reticulata, also known as satsuma or tangerine. So tangerines and mandarins are really the same thing. It's a very large and diverse group with many varieties and hybrids. Clementine is larger than Dancy. It ripens late fall to early winter, juicy and sweet, good for cooler areas. So that would be, if you want to grow clementine, that would be a good one along the coast. Dancy is the standard tangerine in markets, best in hotter areas, and good in zones 21 to 23. They don't list it for 24, which is right along the coast. Ripens late fall to winter. Encore is light orange, thin-skinned, and ripens in summer. And just to take a look at the section on mandarins in the citrus, I'm in the Sunset Western Garden book. Let's see, they say clementine, fruit a little larger than Dancy with fewer seeds, ripens late fall into winter, remains on tree for months, staying juicy and sweet, develop full flavor in areas too cool for a good Dancy, reaches 12 feet in height, semi-open, vertical, spreading somewhat willowy branches, usually bears light crops without another variety for pollination. Dancy is the standard tangerine in markets before Christmas, smaller and seedier than mandarins. Best flavor in zones 12 and 13, but good in 21 through 23. Ripens late fall into winter. Holds well on tree, upright tree with erect branches. Dwarf tree handsome in container as espalier. Encore, light orange, thin skinned. Latest of all the mandarin varieties. Holds until fall. Good quality, erect tree with slender branches. Fairchild, a hybrid between clementine and Orlando tangelo. And then there's Fremont, medium-sized, bright orange, honey, Cara, Kino, Mediterranean, Page, and Pixie, and Satsuma. Satsuma, this is a group of mandarins, is the source of imported canned mandarin oranges. So you can see there's a lot of varieties of mandarin or tangerine, and they do quite well in Southern California. The Tangelo is a hybrid. It's a cross between a mandarin and a grapefruit. And let's bring up number 18, which is the Mineola Tangelo. All are best in warm summer areas. Mineola is a hybrid between dancing mandarin and white-fleshed grapefruit, and here it is. You recognize the Tangelos by this little neck here at where it attaches to the stem. Large, smooth, bright orange, red fruit, tastes like a mandarin, stores on tree for 2 months, mid to late winter, ripening. Orlando, same parents as Mineola, medium-large fruit, looks like a flattened orange. Rind and flesh are orange, matures early in season. And Wickowa is a pink Tangelo. Lavender Gem, a cross between a Tangelo and a grapefruit. Looks like a small grapefruit, tastes like a mixture of sweet orange, grapefruit, and mandarin. And then the Tangor, let's take a look at, okay, so we got that picture. Let's talk about the Tangor hybrid. The Tangor hybrid is a hybrid between mandarins and sweet oranges, often labeled as an orange in markets. Three Tangors are thought to be naturally occurring. There's Temple, grown in low desert, flattened, deep bright orange fruit, is loose-skinned, ripens in early spring, a bushy and thorny tree to 12 feet. The Murcott bears heavily in alternate years, very sweet and seedy, sold as honey tangerine. And the Ortanqui, sweet, juicy, seedy, ripens from spring to summer, large spreading tree. So now let's talk about kumquats. Kumquat is in the genus Fortunella, although some people believe that kumquats should be in the genus Citrus. So there's Fortunella Margarita and Fortunella Japonica, shrub to small tree with yellow to orange fruits that look like tiny oranges. Let's take a look at our next picture, which shows the fruit itself. There you see the tree with the small fruit on it. The rind is sweet, the pulp is tangy, and you eat the fruit whole. Best in areas with warm to hot summers and chilly nights during fall or winter, and remarkably cold tolerant to 18 degrees Fahrenheit. So of all the citrus trees, this one will take the most cold. Let's take a look at picture number 20 to see the fruit. There are several varieties. The Nagami is the main commercial variety, oval, thornless, slightly seedy, more abundant and sweeter in hot summer climates. Miwa, round, sweeter, juicier, and less seedy than other varieties, good for cooler areas, nearly thornless. And the Fukushu is large oval with prominent neck. Skin and juice are sweet, not as sweet as Miwa, compact and thornless. Let's see if we have our next picture, number 20. And if not, then we'll talk about the kumquat hybrids. There's a hybrid kumquat between lime called the limequat, which is a cross between the Mexican lime and the kumquat. Cold tolerant, good lime substitute with an edible rind. Eustace bears fruit shaped like a big olive, and Tavares has elongated fruit. That's the kumquat hybrids. Then there's an orange quat. Nippon is the most commonly grown, cross between Miwa kumquat and Satsuma mandarin. Small round fruit, deep orange with sweet spongy rind and slightly acidic flesh, sweeter than a kumquat. Now, if we don't have number 20, let's go to 21 and talk about citrons. Citron is Citrus medica. Oh, there you go with number 20. This is the kumquat fruit, and I'm not sure which variety this is, but you can see, now you eat these whole, you just pop them in your mouth and chew them all up all at once. The juice will be fairly sour, and the rind is very sweet. But let's move on to number 21, which is a citron. The citron is the oldest known citrus fruit to be cultivated, grown for thick rind, candied and used in fruit cakes, very fragrant fruit. From ancient through medieval times, the citron was used mainly for medical purposes to combat against seasickness, pulmonary troubles, intestinal ailments, and other disorders. Now the next, let's take a look at the next one, which is Citron Ertrag. And this is the typical Citron. The next one we want to look at is actually is the Buddha's hand. So let's take a look at the, so you can see here, this is Buddha's hand. This is a fingered Citron. Here's the bush itself. It's in a full sun, 4 to 6 foot shrub, self-fertile, hardy, and semi-everbearing. They will go deciduous though. This is, so Buddha's hand, fruit developed into fingers that are all rind. It says it has no frost tolerance. And the one we saw earlier was Ertrag. The Ertrag Citron is used by Jews for a religious ritual during the Feast of the Tabernacles. And the fruit resembles a big warty lemon with dry pulp. I see we have a caller. Let's go to our first caller. Who do we have? Terry from Pasadena, you're on the air.
I have a question about my citrus tree. I wanted to know, how do you prune it?
Okay, well, in general, you're going to prune citrus pretty much just the way you prune ornamental shade trees. You want to lightly thin them. You generally want to keep fruit trees at between 12 and 15 feet in height. If you let them get up to 25 feet, it becomes more difficult to pick the fruit. That's true for almost any fruit tree that'll reach that height. So you're going to, as it reaches, you know, that height, you're going to start shortening the tips of the branches. You know, they often accumulate a lot of dead wood. So you want to remove the dead wood, remove crossing branches within the canopy, and lightly thin the canopy. You don't hard prune citrus the way you do stone fruits, apples, and pears. It's really, you know, that's not what you want to do. Excuse me. So, and you don't want to remove more than about 25% of the green wood in a single pruning. Prune them in December or January, avoid any hard pruning, especially in late spring or the summer. You don't want to open up the canopy and let the full sun in on the bark. It'll burn the bark. So light pruning, remove the dead wood. Usually I prune in December or January. And you don't want to prune too late and let that sun in. But it's not too difficult. You do want to keep them at a manageable height, so it makes it easier to pick the fruit.
Okay, well, thank you so much. I really enjoy your show. Thank you.
Well, thank you for calling in.
Bye.
So, yeah, it's not hard to prune citrus. You prune them pretty much the way you would prune any kind of shade tree or ornamental tree. You don't hard prune them like stone fruits, like peaches and nectarines and plums and apricots. Those are hard pruned every winter. You remove nearly two-thirds of the wood. The first response to pruning is rapid new growth. You don't want, so you gotta limit how much you prune oranges or citrus in general. Now, lemons are kind of an exception. Lemons grow like crazy. They're vigorous growers and they throw a lot of water sprouts. Water sprouts are shoots that grow vertically off of a horizontal branch. It shoots up. You want to get in and remove those water sprouts from lemons as soon as you see them starting. They will grow vigorously and be like an independent tree within the canopy, and they kind of disrupt the form you want. So lemons are much more vigorous growers. Limes don't grow quite as vigorously as lemons. Oranges, you're just going to shape them, end up with a symmetrical tree, and take out all that deadwood. They do accumulate deadwood. It's not unusual at all. So we talked about the Citron. Let's talk about the Kalmodrin. Let's take a look at a couple pictures of the Buddha's hand. We got that picture behind me. But let's take a look at 24, which is Buddha's hand. I used to have one of these, but I lost it. It died on me. Bring this up full screen. They're just absolutely spectacular, extremely fragrant. So these are normally brought into the house, and they scent the whole house with that smell of citrus. And you can see all the fingers here. There is no pulp, it's all rind. Take a look at the next picture, which is another Buddha's hand. When I first saw this fruit, I really thought it was the the fruit from outer space. It's just, you know, so unusual. So this is a, if you've got a space for this in your garden, really fun fruit tree to grow. Now the next one is the Calamodon X Citrifornella mitis. This is a hybrid between species in the genera Citra Fortunella and unknown in the wild. And take a look at this. This is a variegated Calamodon. You see the leaves are variegated. So this is a fun little citrus to grow. So now let's talk just a little bit about all the pests and how to water and how to fertilize, because there's so many varieties, you know, it's hard to pick. And if you don't have a lot of space, you'll probably just want to have an orange tree and maybe a lemon or a lime. But if you've got a lot of space, then you can put in a grapefruit, you can put in some of the mandarins from the tangelos and all these interesting hybrids. But I want to first, before we talk about all the different diseases, let's talk about how to water citrus. And in the past, I've talked about irrigation. Let's come back to me. Citrus, I've talked about, when we talked about watering, we talked about applying a certain number of inches. You water landscapes and plants by the inch, just the way you measure rainfall. So it takes about 3 to 4 inches of water to soak the soil to a depth of 2 to 3 feet. And so you soak the tree deep, and then you're going to let it dry out for 2 to 4 weeks, depending on the season. So as soon as, you know, in March, you're going to get water, citrus are watered basically once a month in the spring and the fall, and every 2 to 3 weeks in the summer. If you had heavy clay, you could probably go 3 weeks in the summer. If you've got a sandier soil, you're going to go about every 2 weeks. But if you're out in the desert in Coachella and you're growing, you know, grapefruit and it's just sandy, sandy soil, you're probably going to be watering once a week. So you've got to take into account where you are and what you're growing. I see we have another phone call. Let's go to our next caller. Lee calling from Culver City. You're on the air.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. I am interested in planting some fruit trees that I already have that I've purchased that are in small containers and transferring them to larger containers. And so there's two things, actually two parts to my question. Part one is, what do you think about using like plastic, like food grade, like HDPE or food grade plastic containers for fruit trees versus another kind of material? And the second part to my question is, I was looking online, there's so much conflicting information on what kind of soil to use. Some say just use a soil that you can buy in a bag, you know, that's dedicated for fruit trees, and others say you need to use lots of sand and rock and not that much actual soil. So I was wondering if you could offer me your opinion on both matters.
Okay, so what size are the pots you have right now?
Well, right now they're 5 gallons.
Oh, so you have them in fives now.
So I'm looking to go into probably, you know, at least double that, maybe, you know, triple that size, like maybe a 20 gallon or 15 gallon, something like that.
Yeah.
Well, eventually go bigger than that, but.
Well, the next logical size up is a 15 gallon.
Right.
If you're going to keep them in there for a long time, particularly, I would use a bagged potting soil. If you want to make your own mix, you can, but that's kind of a pain. You'd have to, you know, order the ingredients that people use in potting soils: perlite, vermiculite, silt, things like that. It's much easier just to buy bagged mix. Now, to fill up a 15-gallon pot, you're going to need several bags, and it's, you know, about $8 or $9 a bag.
That was one of the suggestions, was that in nature, the tree would be just as well served by having a like 50-50 mix of sand/ some kind of a gravel and soil. What do you think about that?
No, I wouldn't do that at all.
Okay. I guess that's the internet.
First off, you're not growing it naturally. You're growing it in a pot.
Okay.
So if the best thing for it would be to get it in the ground, but yeah, a lot of people don't have space or they don't have a garden and they want to grow it in pots. You can grow them in large pots for quite a long time, and they do pretty well. So you want to move them into your fives. Now's a perfectly fine time to move them. I would avoid doing that in the heat of the summer. So you either want to do it in the fall or the winter or the early spring. And I would use a potting mix. A bunch of people make potting mix. Kellogg, Bandini, Scott's. They have generic ones at Home Depot.
Just regular potting mix.
But potting mix, not planting soil.
Okay.
and you'll get a much better plant, and you'll get good drainage. If you look at the, you know, what's in it, it's got, it'll have fir bark, you know, a composted fir bark, it'll have perlite, it'll have a lot of stuff. You need, when you're growing in pots, you need excellent drainage. So you, and I don't really see any point to adding any gravel or rock. That's not going to help you a bit.
Okay.
And you said you had some large plastic containers that used to have food in it. That shouldn't be a problem.
They're decorative pots. I flipped them underneath, and they're marked HDPE, which I now see. It says food grade plastic, but I just wanted to get your opinion generally and what you think about growing something we're going to eat. Is it okay to do that, or should I?
Oh, sure. I don't think that's a problem at all.
Okay.
In general, plastics are inert. You know, there's really, the plant's not going to pick up anything from the plastic.
Okay.
And you're better off with a plastic pot versus a clay pot because you won't have to water it as often.
Right. I could barely keep it in the summertime. I couldn't even keep it watered.
And now sometimes people get these very large glazed ceramic pots. They're not cheap. They can be fairly expensive. And then what you do is you take your plastic pot that's nearly the same size and just slip it inside there. That's one way to do it, or you can just plant it right there in it. When you got them in pots, you have to water them a little more frequently because pots dry out much faster than this bulk soil. So whereas if it were planted in the ground, you'd be watering it about every once a month in March, April, May, and June. But in a large pot, I'd probably be watering it every 2 weeks. And in the summer, I'd probably be watering it once a week, especially August and September. You do want to fertilize 3 or 4 times a year with a citrus avocado food and control your pests. But I don't see any problem with using recycled plastic pots. I grow a lot of stuff in pots. I've got way too many plants in pots. And I never use soil. I just buy potting mix, bagged potting mix.
Okay.
It always does better than if I try and make my own mix. Of course, in the commercial nursery industry, they make their own mixes. But their idea is not really to grow it long-term in a pot. They're using sawdust, they may use perlite, you know, they fine-tune their potting mixes for what they're growing. Citrus do need excellent drainage. If you were to use bulk soil, you would probably not be very successful. So I would buy a bag mix.
Okay, am I allowed to slip in one more? Quick question.
Sure, go right ahead.
What I've noticed on my lime trees are looks like, I think it's some kind of white fly or powdery. It looks as though there's an insect there, and it's actually white and powdery on top of it, and there's some black soot around it.
That's definitely a sucking insect. It sounds like mealybug.
Okay.
If you shake the bush and you see little white flies flying all over the place, it's white fly.
Okay.
If you shake it and nothing flies around, and you've got this white fluffy stuff on the undersides of the leaves or down in the crotches of the leaves, that's probably mealybug.
Okay.
That's fairly easy to control with just soapy water.
Oh.
You can use dishwashing soap. You can buy an insecticidal soap, like Safer insecticidal soap. You could use an oil product. You're gonna need to spray the bush about once a week for 3 weeks, usually every spring. Because every spring it flushes new growth, lots of tender, soft leaves. You'll get aphids, mealybug, whitefly. You might get scale insects. They're a little more difficult to control. And the whitefly is a little more difficult to control, too. For the whitefly, you'll often see little white lines on underneath. Wherever the whiteflies walk, they leave a trail of wax. And so if it's whitefly, you'll often see these white mark, you know, you can wipe it off with your finger quite easily. It's just wax. But that's kind of a little tip for determining if you have whitefly versus mealybug. But mealybug is quite common on citrus.
What's the ratio? You just put it in a regular spray bottle or what?
Well, if you buy a product, it'll have instructions on the label. When I use dishwashing soap, I use a teaspoon to a gallon.
Oh, okay. That's not very much. Okay.
No, not much. You could use a tablespoon, too. But, you know, in that range, you know, a teaspoon to a tablespoon to a gallon. Now, citrus is, I've never burned citrus with just dishwashing soap. I did burn some houseplants with dishwashing soap one time. But they were, you know, soft-leaved. And Citrus have those tough, thick leaves, so I wouldn't worry too much about that. But you could use Dawn or any dishwashing soap. Don't use clothes detergent. That's probably too harsh. But yeah, you want to spray it, and you could also, if it's not that big a plant, you could just wash it off with a strong stream of water. But you got to repeat the application. If you're using soaps and oils, you need to repeat the application usually 3 times over a 3-week period.
Okay. Wow, well, thank you so much. I really appreciate all the info.
Okay, good luck with your plants, and thank you for calling in. So let's talk a little bit more about, the pests. So she just mentioned she's got this white fluffy stuff on her leaves, and that's quite commonly going to be mealybug. And there's a citrus mealybug that's quite common on citrus. And you see it almost every spring. If you're growing your, it's hard to avoid it. They're out there in the environment, and they come all over, they come all the time. But I've got an interesting book here. Let's go to the overhead. This is the Color Handbook of Citrus Diseases. By Klotz and Fawcett, published in 1941. Now, Fawcett was a citrus researcher at the Citrus Experiment Station in Riverside in the early 1900s. This experiment station, I believe, was established approximately 1912. And Klotz was also one of the researchers at the facility. And the site, of course, today is the University of California, Riverside, established in 1954. So Fawcett is the father of citrus virology. And then, so you can go through this book. This is blue mold, which is Penicillium italicum that decays a mature fruit. So, a blue contact mold is what they refer to it as. Green mold is also Penicillium, Penicillium digitatum. Here you can see the green mold. But if you look here, this is brown rot, gomosus, and foot rot. This is caused by Phytophthora. And in the old days, they didn't have good resistant rootstocks. And the Phytophthora would move up the trunk and cause these cankers in the trunk. And they would chisel this out and treat it with Bordeaux paste. That would stop the canker. Now we have very good resistant rootstocks. And just to, they show a lot of stuff. Here's armillaria root rot. Let's see what they show you. Here are the mushrooms that form at the base of the infected trees. The mycelial fan you find underneath the bark. And I was just wondering, I just wanted to take a look at some of the nutrient deficiencies. This is zinc deficiency. And areas of yellowing tissue, irregular in outline, occur between the main lateral veins. See, the veins are green, but between the veins, this is zinc and iron deficiencies. So zinc deficiency is between the veins, and iron deficiency, the middle panel, the veins are here green again. So it's amazing that, you know, a lot of our problems really are no different than the problems they had when citrus was grown 100 years ago. This is not what I wanted to show you. I wanted to see some of the other nutrient deficiencies, because I often see a lot of nutrient deficiency. This is boron excess and deficiency. This is called rind oil spot. So there's a lot of problems that citrus can get. Injury by sulfur. So this is a nice little book. I just wanted to show it to you. This is the Color Handbook of Citrus. And I still refer to it, especially for the nutrient deficiencies. One of the ways you can distinguish between nitrogen deficiency and iron deficiency on regardless of the plant is that if you are nitrogen deficient, the new growth will be green and the old growth will turn yellow. If you're really nitrogen deficient, everything turns yellow. If you're iron deficient, the new growth will be yellow and the old growth will stay green. Iron cannot be moved in the canopy. And you need to fertilize your citrus 3 or 4 times a year. You can use a citrus avocado food. You can use cottonseed meal with a little blood meal. But they are high feeders. They use a lot of nitrogen. And so if you don't fertilize them, you will get yellow leaves, either from iron or deficiency, or nitrogen deficiency, or zinc deficiency. And so you need to water properly, fertilize, do a little pruning, control all the insects that are gonna be on there, and be able to diagnose some of your problems would help. And I just wanna maybe quickly, from the Western Citrus, the Sunset Western Citrus, Sunset Western Garden book, excuse me, What Citrus Need. Most kinds of citrus flourish in areas with warm to hot summers and mild winters, Southern California. Soil citrus trees are quite tolerant as long as the soil is well drained. Heavy clays are the most difficult. You got to be very careful of irrigation. Watering, be consistent. Don't let the soil dry out or out completely or get soggy. So if you put a citrus in a lawn and water it three times a week, it's way too frequent. You want to deep water the trees and let them dry out for 2 to 4 weeks. Now you can transition from March, where you really only need to water once in the month, maybe April once in the month. And then in May and June, instead of just two irrigations, you probably do three. So you're gonna do it like every 3 weeks. July, you could continue the 3 week schedule or go to 2 weeks, depending on how hot a year it is and where you are. You know, if you're at the beach, you can go longer between your irrigations than are if you're in the San Gabriel Valley. And if you're out in the desert, out in Coachella or Palm Springs, you're probably going to start watering every week in August and September, certainly, especially if you have sandy soil. So now you can greatly improve your watering efficiency by putting a thick layer of compost on the soil. Let's just talk a little bit about Phytophthora root rot. That's one of the major diseases in citrus. Phytophthora is a water mold. There's two species of Phytophthora that attack citrus, Phytophthora parasitica and Phytophthora, I've had a cold all week and I'm dying. Phytophthora parasitica and Phytophthora attack citrus roots and rot them. They make microscopic sacs on the outside of the root with spores inside these little tiny sacs. Every time you saturate the soil, it releases the spores to another root and start a new infection. The more frequently you irrigate, the more severe the root rot becomes. So the number one way to control root rot is your frequency of irrigation. So if you're watering frequently and keeping the soil wet all the time, you're very likely to get root rot. The tree will have poor growth, a thinning canopy, tip dieback, so you have dying branches. You get small fruit or no fruit. It might not even flower. Don't grow citrus or any fruit trees in lawns. Lawns are watered frequently and shallow, and fruit trees are watered infrequently and deep. Now I do have another video that I really would like to show. And it's the UC Citrus Collection Part 2. Well, they'll talk about more about varieties. Let's take a look at this video. And then when we come back, we'll talk about more about some of the pathogens that you might have to deal with on your citrus or your pests.
With Dave Wilson Nursery. This morning we're out on the UC Riverside Citrus Varietal Collection Block. This is our friend Robert Kruger. He's the curator of the USDA germplasm block of citrus here in Riverside.
So we're looking at a variegated pink-fleshed lemon here, and variegation is something that we occasionally see as a mutation on various things. We have variegated lemons, variegated sour oranges, variegated Valencias, and variegated navels. The variegation always produces a weaker tree just because we can't get as much photosynthesis out of it. So a lemon is probably least affected just because lemons are so vigorous anyway. This one's also interesting because the immature fruit also are sectored between green and yellow flesh. We cut it open. We also have a mature one here which has lost the variegation. And so this guy, the immature one, does show the pink color. And if we look at the mature one, you can see that, well, this one's overly, this is overripe, but you can see that as a mature fruit, it will also maintain the pink color. However, if you make juice for it, you do not get pink lemonade, you just get regular colored lemonade.
I think this has always been an interesting variety to me because it really falls into the category of edible ornamental.
Right. This is a calamondin. The calamondin is thought to be a cross, naturally occurring cross between a kumquat and a mandarin. So these are also native to southeastern Asia and the islands around there, Malaysia and Indonesia. And they can be consumed, but people here in the U.S. don't really have a tongue for them, so to speak. They make a nice looking tree. You've got some small bright fruits and kind of an upright columnar type of growth on them. To my right, we have the variegated version of the same thing. And again, this would make a nice looking ornamental tree in somebody's yard with immature variegated and mature orange fruits on it.
Yeah, real uniform variegation to the foliage, and that nice, wonderful little variegated fruit makes it a real nice edible ornamental.
This is the seedless kishu, or in Japanese, makaka kishu. It's a small mandarin. These are obviously immature right now in October, but they won't get a whole lot bigger than this even around February when they're ripe. And they are very easy to peel at that time. They're seedless and they're really sweet. So you can take one of these and eat the whole thing, you know, in one bite and have a nice little refreshing piece of fruit. So they're a good backyard tree. This is a miwa kumquat. Kumquats are, again, native to China. And they are native to more of a northern part of China. So these are actually fairly cold tolerant compared to a lot of our citrus. The kumquats are actually a related genus, Fortunella. And they're interesting because they have a sweet rind, and that's why you can eat the whole fruit, as Tom is doing here. Kumquats tend to be a small tree, and a lot of people can grow one in a pot in their backyard for years and years with no problem. The miwa is a round type, and the gami is an oval type. We now have the so-called giant seedless nagami, which I'm not going to show you today, but it produces a little bit bigger nagami fruit that's seedless.
I have a miwa in a barrel, in a half barrel, actually on trifoliate, that I've had now for 28 years. It's actually lived through, I've had to replace the barrel four times because the barrel's rotted out underneath it. So I just keep it, you know, nice and rounded off, and produces 150, 200 fruit every year, and it survived the December 1990 frost without a whole lot of issues, and just a wonderful plant.
So we're looking at a trifoliate orange. The trifoliate oranges are not truly oranges, but they kind of look like oranges, so they're called trifoliate oranges starting, you know, over 100 years ago. And they're very important for use as a rootstock. This is a particular type called Flying Dragon from Japan. And as you can see, the branches are very twisted and tortuous, as are the thorns. Citrus very commonly has thorns, but doesn't usually have this really curvy type of thorn. Here's a nice looking example right here. And Flying Dragon is interesting too, because it'll produce a fly or a dwarf tree when used as a rootstock. So if you bud on the Flying Dragon tree, after 10 or 20 years, you might have a 6 foot tall tree is all. So
would you say, Robert, that the dwarfing characteristic on Flying Dragon is pretty uniform, spread out amongst the different citrus varieties grafted onto it?
For the most part, yes. Some of them are less dwarfed than others, but the common types of sweet oranges and the mandarins that you use will definitely be a small tree. This is Mauna Loa grapefruit from Hawaii, and this one is always interesting because it consistently produces some of our largest fruit on the field station here. These are a good sized fruit, but they sometimes will get maybe almost 50% larger than this. These are last year's fruit. You can see here's another one, and it's not a particularly interesting tasting fruit, but it's, you know, a lot of fun to look at.
Is this a pink flesh or a yellow flesh?
Yeah, it's pink. Yeah, it's pink flesh.
Yeah.
This is a sepal orange. It's from Brazil. It's a sweet orange. There's nothing particularly interesting about the fruit, but the tree itself has what they call a recumbent growth habit. So it's kind of what people would describe as weeping. Instead of growing up, the branches tend to curve downwards. So the tree stays very small and compact.
Yeah, it really does have a very nice pendulous compact growth habit. Would make a really nice ornamental.
Yeah, and the fruit, there's nothing great about it, but certainly a, you know, nice enough fruit to have as a sweet orange, comes mature about December, January. There's another type in Brazil, which I've not personally seen, but I'm told grows like a vine. So there's still unexplored stuff that we don't have here in the collection yet.
Is this seedless or seedy?
This is a seedy type, unfortunately.
Yeah, but good juice?
Good juice, yeah.
Very nice.
Right now we're standing in a row of pomelo seedlings. Pomelos are a type of fruit that some people describe as being kind of like a grapefruit. They're from Southeast Asia and they're consumed a lot in places like Vietnam and Thailand. This row of trees was propagated from some seeds received quite a while ago from some people that were doing plant exploration in Vietnam for other purposes, and they came back labeled boy. Well, I found out since then that boy is the generic Vietnamese word for a pomelo. About 6 or 7 years ago, we had a visitor, Dr. Trin from Vietnam, and we were showing him these pomelos, and he said that this particular seedling tree resembled their Vietnam variety, which was called Nam Roy. Nam Roy means five hits. And the reason it was called this is because this tree was growing in the village and the fruit was so good, the boys in the village would climb up the tree to steal the fruit. When the owner would find them, he would hit them five times with a stick, but the fruit was good enough that they'd risk this beating with the five blows in order to get the fruit, and that's why it was called Nam Roy, or five blows.
Oh, that's a great story.
This is Weber Shaddock, and this is one of our, I'll call it at this point only a semi-mystery because we think we figured it out. One of our former colleagues, Ms. Tutsbeer, and I discovered this out in an abandoned date retail outlet near Indio, Jensen's Date Garden. All the signs were falling over, so we collected things we looked interesting and hoped that the signs corresponded more or less to what they was. This was called Weber Shaddock. It's something we did not have in Riverside, and it's definitely a shaddock or a grapefruit pomelo type thing. And I was recently in Florida and observing it in Florida, and it seems to be what they're calling Weber in Florida seems to correspond with this. And this is actually a pretty nice tasting fruit. It might be a little early, so I'll taste it myself rather than subjecting anybody else to it.
Well, I'll try it. Here we go. Nice flavor.
A little early, a little crunchy, but nice flavor.
Yeah. I can see that where that would pick up a lot of character in about another 6 weeks.
Right. This is another historical variety. This is propagated from a tree down at the Awatibia Ranch in Pala that's over 100 years old. So this is a Valencia-type orange and might represent an earlier type of Valencia than those we commonly grow now. So it's still a small tree, so we don't really have a lot of data or information on it, but it's interesting for, because of its historical roots.
So that's, you know, really fun to see all the different varieties out there at the USDA Germplasm Repository at the Citrus Field Station in Riverside with over 1,000 varieties. I'd heard 600, but they in the video they were saying 1,000. Let's take a look at a few diseases. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is Armillaria mellea, or the oak root rot fungus. Let's take a look at this next picture, number 27. These are Armillaria mushrooms. And citrus is fairly resistant to Armillaria compared to like a peach, which dies very rapidly from it. And you'll see these mushrooms will come up in January and February at the base of trees, usually when they're dying. And if you see this, you know, there's no control. Now, if you pull the bark off the base of the tree, let's just jump ahead to number 30. And see the mycelial fans under the bark. If you pull the bark off the tree, you find this white growth between the bark and the wood. That would indicate, again, it's diagnostic for Armillaria mellea or oak root rot fungus. And this is a, you know, will eventually kill your tree, and especially if you're watering it too frequently. So the mushrooms are kind of tan colored. All the stems are united at the base. It has a ring or an annulus very close up to the cap. And the gills are decurrent, which means they run down the stem a little bit. The mushrooms are very bitter when eaten raw, but they are edible. They need to be cooked. And let's see if we have number 30 that we could bring up. And you'll see the white mycelial fans. Well, this is actually a close-up of the mushroom. Here's the ring that's quite high up. And these gills actually run down the stem just a little bit. That's decurrent. Let's go to the next picture, which again shows another clump of the mushrooms. All the stems are united at the base. And you got the high annulus. If you take a spore print, it'll from the cap, it'll be creamy white. Let's look at the take a look at the next picture. And this is the mycelial fan that you find under the bark. This is not right on citrus. This is actually from a different tree, Italian cypress. We have an email question. Can you talk a little more about citrus minor and squirrel control? Okay, citrus leaf miner. Let's take a look at, let's just take, move to the next picture. We're going to do miner right away. Let's do take a look at 31. This is Diaprepes root weevil. And this is introduced about 5-10 years ago. It was introduced into Southern California. The larva feed on the roots, and the weevil will emerge from the soil and eat the leaves. It's called the citrus root weevil, or Diaprepes root weevil, and is particularly damaging. Our next picture is the citrus leaf miner, and we could just run through these next pictures rather quickly. You can see the twisted and contorted leaves. Here's the pattern that the miner makes in the leaf, and you can see these leaves are all twisted and contorted. Next picture. And again, you can see the pattern. Here's the miner. It starts off, usually it probably started here. You see this, how it's very small, and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Then it pupates and it flies off as a moth. Let's take a look at the next picture, which is the actual moth. This is the citrus leaf miner. You will not get any infestation in spring. It's too cold for the moth to be active. Starting about mid-June, you'll start to see the very beginnings. You might see some activity. And that's when you can start spraying with spinosad. Spinosad is an organically registered insecticide to control chewing insects and caterpillars and leaf miners. You need to spray You need to spray about every 2 weeks, starting about mid-June. And you're going to spray, so you probably spray once in June, twice in July, twice in August, probably twice in September. And that's a lot of spraying. On mature trees, it doesn't hurt the tree very much. But on young, newly planted trees or nursery production, it can slow their growth and it's not good. And you said the citrus leaf miner, and I forget the other question they had. So that's the citrus leaf miner, and it's quite common and widespread. Now, squirrel control. Well, you're going to have to net the trees with bird netting and take it all the way to the bottom of the tree. You might need, if you've got a smaller tree, it's much easier, but you know, if, say you got a 12-foot tree, probably need a couple pieces of the bird netting. Wrap the whole tree. They're probably not going to eat the fruit until it starts to color up, so I would probably wrap the tree in early December before it starts to color up, maybe the last week of November, right in there. Take it to the ground, dig a little trench, put it in the soil, or put rocks on it, and you've got to make sure they can't get underneath that bird netting. That's really the only way you're going to keep them off. The other thing is to trap the squirrels and try and reduce their population. That can be difficult. There's a lot of these fox squirrels that are introduced from the East Coast. So the squirrels are very hard to control. Usually I have a problem with rats chewing and eating all the flesh out. And so I bait the rats. And squirrels will take some of the fruit, but they won't do as much damage as rats do. Rats are far more common. And they just leave the rind with a big hole in it, and it's hollow. That's rat damage. So that, don't confuse that with squirrel damage, but squirrels can be quite damaging as well. Well, we're running out of time. We'll be back next week with another program, and we'll probably talk about deadly tree diseases, although I haven't checked the schedule today and I don't recall. I want to thank the crew for their hard work today putting on the show, and apologize if I coughed a lot. I've had a cold all week. But we'll be back next week, and until then, I'd like to wish you a happy gardening. Thank the crew for their hard work. Enjoy our wonderful weather. Get out and enjoy your garden. Take care.